Hello, everyone. I am Dr. Laurel Cook, Associate Professor of Marketing at West Virginia University. This lecture is a combination of Chapters 1 and 2, Internet and Mobile Marketing and the Value Chain Online. Some material in this lecture is not included in your text. So much of what we learn as digital marketers is brand new, brought to you by advances in marketing research and internet technologies. Let's get started. Adapting to and thriving in the digital ecosystem requires a strategic process of digital transformation. There are a number of technologies that are at the heart of transformation currently. Artificial intelligence is not new, but it is just coming into its own as a driver of many business innovations. Virtual reality, augmented reality, and mixed reality applications are now emerging in many products and services. All users have an abundance of choices in what they consume and how they consume it. Choice is never far away from the digital user. As a result, the concept of consumer experience has assumed a dominant role in successful marketing of all kinds. Technology is important, yes, but it is not the cornerstone of successful consumer experience. There are many dimensions of consumer experience, and these will be emphasized here and throughout the rest of the semester. The image shown on the screen is a nice demonstration of digital media and traditional media across the years. Here we see the latest update, and as you can see, in 2020 of last year, the number of digital media hours consumed far surpassed traditional media, although both have increased from last year. So 451 hours of digital media consumed online is about 7.5 hours total every day. You can see just a few years ago how in 2018 the numbers for each were about equal. And prior to 2018, traditional media still outweighed digital media. That's no longer the case. And of course, this emphasizes the exciting future for you as a digital marketer. As you know, the internet has been one of the most transformative and fast-growing technologies. The internet continues to be the most democratic of all the mass media. With a very low investment, anyone can have a web page online. In this way, almost any business can reach a very large market directly, fast, and economically, no matter the size or location of that company. With a very low investment, almost anybody that can read and write can have access and a presence online. And as you can see, the start of the internet was pretty slow from 1957 until about the early 1990s. In the late 90s, until about 2004, the growth of the internet was extremely fast. Since 2005 until the present day, the internet growth has remained stable. But today in 2021, two things have marked the evolution of the internet and growth in exciting areas. The first, of course, is the social web, and more importantly is number two, mobile technology. We'll cover these factors in great detail over the course of this semester. So how many websites are there? A few years ago, we had about 1.24 billion websites worldwide. Today, that number is nearly 2 billion websites. Believe it or not, the most expensive website to date is LasVegas.com, which was sold for a staggering $90 million. And here's another fun fact for you. The total number of websites is more than or exceeds the number of registered domain names because many sites run on subdomains. Platforms like WordPress.com and Tumblr host millions of sites on subdomains. Here's a fun example from 1999 from a famous musician who predicted back then how big the internet was going to be. As you know, he's a musician and really at the cusp of the rise and fast growth of the internet. But even he had the insight to understand how the internet might have a huge impact on the world.
And the internet is now carries the flag of being subversive and possibly rebellious and chaotic, nihilistic and... Oh, yes, it is. Forget about the Microsoft element. The monopolies do not have a monopoly, maybe on programs.
What you like about the fact, what you like about it is the fact that anyone can say anything. or do anything?
From my standpoint, from where I am, because of the by virtue of the fact that I am a pop singer and writer, I embrace the idea that there's a new demystification process going on between the artist and the audience. I think when you look back at, say, this last decade, there hasn't really been one single entity, artist or group, that have personified or become the brand name for the 90s. It was starting to fade a little in the 80s, and in the 70s there were still definite artists, in the 60s there were the Beatles and the Hendrix, and in the 50s there was Presley. Now it's subgroups and genres. It's hip-hop, it's girl power, it's it's a communal kind of thing. Mm. It's about the community. It's becoming more and more about the audience, because the point of having somebody who led the forces has disappeared, because the vocabulary of rock is too well known. It's a currency that is not, it's not devoid of meaning anymore, but it's certainly only a conveyor of information now. It's not a conveyor of rebellion. And the internet has taken on that, as I say. And so I find that a terribly exciting area.
Let's continue our discussion by discussing marketing then versus marketing now. Today, marketers have more money, which means they can do more marketing, especially in digital channels. The final purchase is not the end of the buyer journey, and digital marketing is a big part of this. The focus now in marketing is on content, for example, how-to videos, and on voice search, for example, using Google or Alexa. An omni-channel approach still utilizes traditional marketing methods. Remember, omni-channel is when a consumer or marketer uses multiple channels at the same time. We'll begin by discussing where marketing isn't headed, specifically in the social media space. For example, many Twitter users complain about there being a lack of an edit feature. Of course, the CEO, Jack Dorsey, explains why an edit feature is unlikely to ever happen. He says, "The reason there's no edit button, and there hasn't been an edit button traditionally, is because Twitter started as an SMS text messaging service. When you send a text or a tweet, you can't really take it back. So while the edit feature is unlikely to happen, you have seen something new appear in Twitter with fleets or fleeting tweets. So Twitter does have an update allowing users to send tweets that disappear. Another update is the integration of AI by more firms. Specifically, what you can expect is the increase of chatbots. Many digital marketers believe that next year bots will become more self-learning and will easily match particular users' needs and behavior. That means that a 24/7 operating bot will be able to replace support managers and save costs for many companies. In the next 10 years, chatbots will remain the most common instrument to serve people and become the major branch of digital development. The most important advantage of AI-based bots that you need to understand are 24/7 problem-solving potential, the human-like experience, and deep consumer behavior analytics. Another new update to be on the lookout for are differences in Google algorithms. The latest and greatest algorithm is Google BERT, and we'll talk about how each of these algorithms work specifically. But since they affect search results, the implications of any new developments in Google and its algorithms is critical for digital marketers to understand. Another update this year is an even greater focus on all things diversity. As you can see based on the image on the screen, accessibility doesn't necessarily imply that a user or consumer is born a specific way with some sort of deficit or inability. There can also be temporary and situational deficits or accessibility-related issues. Accessibility-related issues will affect your role as a digital marketer and how information is communicated online. For example, if you tweet an image, do you always add alt text to your images? You may not have considered it before, but alt text is key not just for those who are deaf or hard of hearing, but also for voice search assistants like Google or Alexa. So while accessibility may not have been important to you now, it's extremely likely to be important to your role as a digital marketer. There are some primary differences that you as a student need to understand between traditional and digital marketing. As I've mentioned before, a huge advantage to having information online is scalability, meaning barriers to entry are reduced online. For example, you can start a business in your garage and communicate information about your brand new brand, not only locally, but globally as well. Of course, digital offers customization of content, two-way interaction, which reflects the inbound marketing philosophy, lots of data, a lot more information can be inferred or collected about a consumer based on their online activity. A lot of the data is stored by IoT, otherwise known as Internet of Things. Another difference is cost efficiency. Specifically, it's much cheaper for information to be communicated from a brand to the consumer online. Dovetailing with this benefit is the fact that information can be communicated in real time. Anything in print, like a magazine or a newspaper ad, is dated almost as soon as it's printed. Another advantage is viral dissemination. Next, I find it helpful to describe to students where we started with the web and where we are today. Naturally, we began with Web 1.0, and you would think every website created and launched during this period would be gone, but that's not necessarily the case. And humorously, the site you see on the screen right now from 96, Space Jam, has been around for many years and is still alive today. Most sites, however, exist in a Web 2.0 world. It's not where the most innovative marketers are today, but still a lot of firms find themselves operating in a Web 2.0 space. You may remember from your Chapter 1 reading, the idea of services, in other words, not packaged software with cost-effective scalability. Cloud computing is a great example of what I'm referring to here, and that's the current manifestation of this principle. Web 2.0 also includes unique behavioral data. In other words, marketers can understand more about a user well beyond demographic information. In line with the idea of users as co-developers is that of harnessing the collective intelligence. Web 2.0 also includes the idea of leveraging the long tail. The long tail is a search marketing term that implies specialty markets. These small, underserved markets can become exceedingly profitable, especially when customers help keep costs down by serving themselves. In Web 2.0, you also have software that is increasingly device agnostic. When I say agnostic, typically that refers to a person who believes that nothing is known or can be known. So device agnostic is software that isn't dependent on a particular type of device, like Apple or Samsung. You also have lightweight user interfaces, development models, and business models. What that means are applications that are easy to use, flexible, and portable between different computing environments. Web 3.0 is the space where you're likely to work as a digital marketer. Web 3.0 is real time. It capitalizes on trends and is fast. Another huge component of Web 3.0 is the use of semantics. And what I mean by semantics is illustrated in the image you see on the screen now. In other words, user intent. So in a typical Google search bar, you can type in the first few words and Google will use semantics or prediction to guess what your search term will be. Mobile and geolocation is critically important for businesses. And there's also an understanding of ownership of data and a respect for consumers' privacy. There are many marketers that predict this idea of blockchain will power Web 3.0. In other words, many expect that the web will undergo a major, huge transformation that's going to last well beyond 2021. And this transformation will be courtesy of blockchain. While you as a marketer don't need to know the specific details of how blockchain works, you should understand that basically it's a technology that underpins digital currency. Blockchain technology allows digital information to be distributed, but not copied. This means that each individual piece of data can only have one owner. The key thing you need to remember here is that blockchain will be the driving force behind Web 3.0 and the semantic web. The semantic web, again, is illustrated with the examples you see on the screen. I'm a professor who, and you see the results that populate automatically. I also put in, I'm a college student who really, and you can see the humorous results that Google predicts. Finally, for this chapter, there's a lot of theory and prediction for where digital marketing is headed. And what you should understand is how to use that information or these predictions as marketing strategy. So here are some best practices for strategic drivers. You're going to see a lot of these practices described again as we cover each of the specific digital marketing chapters this semester. The first is personalized content. Information communicated by you to your user, for example, an email, social media, and on your website, can and should be personalized in many cases. This strategy offers meaningful communication to your user. Another best practice is the idea of real-time mega reach. Fresh and new, consistent content is also key. And consumer-led advertising, in other words, word of mouth. Consumer-generated networks, fully informing your consumers, and scaling up or down as needed are the remaining best practices described here. Now our discussion moves to Chapter 2, the Internet Value Chain and Digital Marketing Revolution. Chapter 2 provides an important lesson for you students. Digital marketing is much more than cool websites, games, or interactive ads. The idea of value here explains why we bother doing what we do as marketers online. This chapter forms the basis of a solid understanding of the transformational change being created throughout the economy by technology, and it provides a place to highlight some of the key technologies here. We'll cover those in more detail in just a minute. Let me begin by showing you a short clip from Family Feud Canada. The idea here is for you to understand this idea of value in a different way. The very best brands understand how to communicate value in real time. And the key connection here to this Family Feud example is the capitalization of current trends. In this example, you'll see a woman who's missed out on $10,000 with her wrong answer on Family Feud Canada. But this viral video of her answer actually ended up getting her $10,000 worth of free food.
All right. Real simple. There's one question, only one answer. Whoever gets it, you're playing for $10,000. That's it. Whoever guesses this wins the game. Here we go. Name Popeye's favorite food.
Chicken.
Oh my God.
Show me chicken.
Here you can see how Popeye's humorously took advantage of the situation. And this is one of my favorite examples of a brand who understands value, especially in real time, and especially in connection to trends. So this idea of value can even be communicated by you as digital marketing students right now, even in something as simple as a tagline. You're going to use taglines in this class. For example, your Google Ads will include taglines. Email marketers, of course, use taglines. The example in green says, don't want to answer questions in class? Use this simple trick. So here, value is communicated very well, and enough to entice the user to find out more information. The example in red says, she fell down 1,000 steps during her freshman year, but she healed before an important job interview. Not only is this a very lengthy and undesirable tagline, but it communicates value differently and less effectively. So for those of you who were motivated economically, you want to hear how much value is really worth. Online, the internet value chain is estimated to be worth $5.8 trillion. So the internet value chain is, in essence, the economics of the internet. The idea of a value chain is pretty important here. All of the sections you see on the screen now represent opportunities for content creation. We're going to come back to this idea of content creation over and over. It's key for this semester. And when I say content creation, imagine storytelling for a brand. For example, product development, you can talk about the consumer collaboration. In other words, how consumers help to create the product you're selling. For material suppliers, you can talk about how you use only sustainable materials Or maybe your brand networks with female small business owners in Africa. You see with these examples how value is communicated in a great way. As a digital marketer, you may not play a role in the pre-production or production of the goods and services you sell, but you should still understand that value is embedded at every step of the process. The image shown on your screen illustrates a very interesting idea of demand-driven supply chain. In other words, information flows separate from the flow of physical products. So this supply chain advancement is a great idea of embedding value at every step of the process. My question for you now is there a real-world example of a company that makes this more explicit for consumers? Can you think about how this is done by a brand today? Remember how Domino's used to communicate value to its consumers? Value used to be communicated in the actual product it sold. With this Domino's tracker, you can see how value is being communicated differently and in a more enhanced fashion. So what are the factors of the value chain online? Well, you have four primary factors that are affecting the value chain. And those include information search costs, transaction costs, fragmentation of customer markets, and standardized products. But the first two represent 40% of total costs. So to improve cost efficiency, consider these three factors: visibility, mirroring, and enhancing customer value. The idea of visibility is mostly about activities occurring within the firm. But remember, consumers respond well to visibility and transparency too. Mirroring is the ability to create information systems that share complete pictures of a supply chain. Enhanced value creation is beautifully illustrated with the example you see on the screen by Nike. Of course, Nike offers a whole array of physical products, but they also offer the Nike Run Club. They tout the Nike Run Club as the perfect running partner for its consumers. So you can see how something as simple as the app and the club combine to enhance the products that Nike sells. A key principle discussed in this chapter that's near and dear to my heart is that of this idea of service-dominant logic. Service-dominant logic, otherwise known as SDL, is this idea that your products or goods are vehicles for service. Most of us, when we think of service provision, think of restaurants, dry cleaners, that sort of thing. But a product can also provide service to consumers. SDL also tells the idea that customers are co-creators of value. In other words, if Nike creates a new pair of shoes, the value doesn't come necessarily solely from Nike. An SDL view is very customer-oriented and relational. We need to cover a few key technologies important to this idea of value creation. The first is EDI, also known as Electronic Data Interchange. The example shown on the screen illustrates what EDI looks like. But the key value here for you to understand is that it makes transactions paperless. Next is ERP, or Enterprise Resource Planning. One of ERP's biggest values is how its software is used to reduce inventory. Next are web services. The huge value add here is that it's software agnostic communication. In other words, it's not device dependent. Communication can occur seamlessly through web services despite the device a user has. Next is cloud computing. And the huge advantage here that it offers for both the brand and users is that it's scalable and elastic. And finally, we'll discuss RFID technology. In other words, radio frequency ID tech. The huge advantage here is its real-time tracking. As we continue our discussion of value creation, it's important for us to understand some primary definitions. You've heard me use the term digital marketing many times by now, but understand that it's basically an umbrella term that refers to digital media, including email, websites, search engines, and social mobile media platforms. Social media, of course, include apps that enable users to create their own content and share it with others who access the same website or app. And mobile computing is technology that allows the transmission of data, voice, and video through any wireless-enabled computing device without a fixed physical connection. The exciting thing of being a digital marketer these days, and for as long as I can remember, is the phenomenon known as digital disruption. Digital disruption is a change that occurs when new digital technology and business models affect the value proposition of existing goods and services. A common example you may identify with that may help you understand this idea of digital disruption is that of Netflix, when they innovated this idea of on-demand entertainment. And of course, others followed, and this created a disruption for the entertainment industry. Often, when disruption occurs online, it leads to digital transformation. This concept is the profound and accelerating transformation of business activities, processes, competencies, and models to fully leverage the changes and opportunities of digital tech. In other words, digital is the application of information and tech to raise human performance. One of the biggest transformations is this idea of IoT, or Internet of Things. There are two concepts. The first is Internet of Things, and the second is Internet of Everything. And people often use these two interchangeably, but people are often wrong. IoT is the way physical objects communicate through the Internet. For example, when your toaster DMs your thermostat. IoE is IoT on steroids, streamlining connectivity between people, data, processes, and things. To further illustrate how this transformation has grown, consider this goal that you see on the screen now. What if I told you, as a digital marketer, that you needed to reach 50 million users? You can see across the different technologies how long it would take to reach 50 million users for a brand. This is a perfect illustration of the diffusion of technology that highlights the always connected consumer. It's only fair for us as marketers to consider the good and the bad that has resulted from digital transformations. Consider one good example. We're about to celebrate the Super Bowl. This year, the cost for a 30-second ad to be played during the Super Bowl remained constant at $5.6 million, but the total cost increased to $5.8 million if you add $20,000 for online streaming. Consider how that's raised when the cost of a 30-second space was only $2.96 million back in 2010. In other words, traditional TV advertising today has gotten very expensive. Alternatively, a national-sponsored Snapchat lens, like the example shown on the screen, costs roughly $329,000, meaning advertisers could create 17 of these for the same cost as one 30-second ad. Another good outcome is the fact that every user online has an individualized digital footprint. This is information about us that exists online as a result of our activity, what we search for, what we watch, that sort of thing. To illustrate what I mean, here's an extra credit opportunity. If you visit the following website, you'll be able to ascertain your own digital footprint. Visit applymagicsauce.com to see what your digital footprint looks like. There are a few bad outcomes from digital transformation, and many of these are cultural. Consider the idea of FOMO, or the fear of missing out. So with all the social media content being added online, users can feel psychological deprivation. The example you see on the screen is a PSA created by a group of my consumer behavior students. And it also illustrates another bad outcome from the digital transformation. More recently, you've heard a lot in the news about the idea of consumer privacy online. I've mentioned that one of the best outcomes of the digital revolution and transformation is all the information marketers can glean about a user. But I would suggest to you as students, it's best to use this information with a user's consent. Governments across the world are now taking note of how consumers respond to their information being used online. For this reason, you have one search engine called DuckDuckGo that specifically advertises the fact that it doesn't track consumers. Consider the impact this has on marketing practice. For example, here are the different types of media that marketers can utilize: earned, paid, owned, and shared. Which ones do you think the savviest marketers will try to utilize the most? If you said earned and shared, you would be right. These type of media cost less and are often trusted more by users. A.G. Lafley, the Procter & Gamble CEO, is famous for having said, "The best brands consistently win two moments of truth." And he described the first moment of truth and the second moment of truth. The first moment of truth being a consumer's experience with a product, for example, at the shelf. And the second moment of truth is the experience when they take that product home. But hopefully you're savvy enough to understand that these two moments of truth may not really reflect consumers' decision-making journey. In early 2012, Google's Jim Lisinski published an ebook called ZMOT, Winning the Zero Moment of Truth. In contrast with Procter & Gamble's philosophy, the zero moment of truth is the moment when a customer uses a digital device to begin learning about a potential purchase. In Lisinski's own words, it is that moment when you grab your laptop, your phone, or some other device and start learning about a product or service you're thinking about trying or buying. For this reason, I think it's critical for you as digital marketers for you to understand this important concept of the zero moment of truth. You can see how a customer's journey really occurs much sooner than when he or she arrives at the store or at the shelf. So how do companies make sure their websites and other online content are their first ones found when consumers reach a ZMOT, a zero moment of truth? A big part of that answer is through the use of search engine optimization, SEO, and search engine marketing, or SEM. SEO is merely the process of getting more traffic based on higher rankings from free or organic search results. Related to this is the idea of SEM, or search engine marketing, which is the process of generating website traffic by purchasing ads on search engines, for example, Google Ads, and potentially using SEO practices. And I'll leave you with this question. Is Google the only player here? Google may dominate the desktop search market, but Yahoo, Bing, and Ask.com rival Google in the mobile search space. So consider the role that these other players may have in SEO and SEM.